Welcome to Chase Oaks this weekend. We are so glad that you're a part of our weekend experience. I get the honor and privilege this weekend to continue a series called Solid. And here's the reality. I think a lot of people find themselves in situations that, well, aren't all that solid, could find themselves on shaky ground. And I believe that today's message is going to add value to your life. Before I give that message, we're going to enjoy a song. You've probably heard it on the radio at least once or twice. And it's just a song about the fact that all of us can find ourselves in a boat where, hey, we make mistakes and things don't always go in our favor. But hey, we're all in that boat together. And I believe that this weekend, perhaps some things can turn around. So join us as we sing.
Need someone. I'll pick up the pieces if you come undone. Fading stars up on your ceiling, 'cause you wish that you could find some feeling. Yeah, you know you can call me if you need someone. I need you to hold.
Welcome to Chase Oaks Online. We're so glad that you're here, and we've got Liz back with us this week.
Yes,
Liz, how are you?
That was an amazing song. Got me really pumped up for our third week in our series called Solid. I'm really excited to hear from Ryan all about being solid in our personal lives. So we're so glad you're here with us.
Yes, and if this is your first week tuning in, we're so glad that you're here, and we'd love to connect with you, and more importantly, get you plugged in with us. So if you will, text NEW to 58578, and we'll reach out later this week.
All right, well, you know what this week is. For some people, it's the last week of school.
Yes.
Maybe next week is the last week of school. I don't know what...
If you're Garland, it's a couple more weeks,
yeah, I think. Richards is next week. Okay, but you know what's really important is summer is here. That means vacations. You're leaving soon.
Mm-hmm.
Getting excited. I'm going to go to the beach, and we're just all thinking that way. But this is awesome. We have several ways this summer where we can take tangible steps forward to developing our faith and even learning some new things things to help us in practical ways, and it's just such a good time to do that. And one of them is Established.
Yes, so if you haven't heard, Established is a 10-week group, and it's designed to develop you, your knowledge of the Bible, mm-hmm. develop some new friendships with people at Chase Oaks. And they're starting up both online and in person. So if you're interested, go ahead and make your way to the website. They're starting up soon. And then on top of that, we also have 5 masterclasses on some pretty relevant topics. So Liz, can you tell us a little bit about those?
Yes, they're amazing topics. There's understanding the Bible, finances, leadership, parenting, and finding out your gifts and learning about your purpose. And did I get them all? I don't know if I counted that right. But
Yes. Anyways,
amazing classes. I really just don't know which one to choose. So it's going to be a great summer to just dive in to learn more about how we can be really solid personally, which is going great with what we're going to hear from Ryan in a little bit. But these are digital and on demand, and we do need you to register. And the really cool thing, Matt, is that this summer you can do these classes on your own in your own pace or with a friend or a group. And so there's just so many different opportunities for us this summer.
That's awesome. Well, if you will stick around to the end of the service, we're going to be back with some information about some cool things going on next weekend. But now we're going to go ahead and kick it over to Ryan with our third week of Solid.
Welcome to Chase Oaks. We're so glad that you're here. Wherever you're watching from, I believe that today's message is going to add value to your life. We have been in a series called Solid. We started off Mother's Day weekend talking about what it looks like to be a solid parent. And then last week we talked about what it looks like to have solid thinking. Today I want to talk to you about what it looks like to just be solid personally. I don't know if somebody's ever asked you, hey, how you doing? You said to them, solid. Now, I don't know what, if we were feeling the opposite of solid, if we would say, I feel shaky. Like, I've never heard anybody say that out loud to me. You know, no one just comes out right away and just goes, having a shaky day, what about you? Like, nobody says that, but the reality is, a lot of people find themselves in that situation, don't they? I mean, a lot of people can't seem to have solid relationships. A lot of people can't seem to have a solid job. A lot of people can't seem to have solid finances, and here's what I want you to know this weekend. Even if you don't have solid circumstances, you can be solid personally. You can be solid yourself, even when everything around you might be shaky. I think that is at the essence of what it means to be a Christian, is somebody that is truly solid. Now, when I talk about being a Christian, a lot of things might come to mind for you. Like, when you think of what is the definition of being a Christian, what comes to mind? My brother asked this question on Facebook once, and he got 185 comments, okay? Different people trying to define for them, hey, this is what I think it looks like to be a Christian. And here's what I've discovered. I actually looked this number up because I was just curious, and this is very interesting. Did you know that there are 13,000 different denominations in America? Which would lead me to say this. If someone were to say, I'm a Christian, I would respond with, what kind? I mean, ultimately, isn't that the question? Because you're going, it can be represented in 13,000 different ways to make. So if someone is trying to understand the brand of Christianity, if I wasn't a Christian, I think I would be pretty confused. I would be looking around going, well what is it that Christians are really going to hang their hat on? I mean, ultimately, the question I want to answer in the next few moments that we have together is this. What's the goal line for being called a solid Christian? I mean, what does that really mean? I love when I'm talking to my single friends and they're dating somebody and I'll ask them this question. Are they a Christian? They go, well, I mean, they go to church. I'm like, do they go to Chipotle? That doesn't make them a burrito. What do you mean? Are they a Christian or not? Are they a solid Christian? Well, what do you, talk to me. What is that? What does that really mean? I want to unpack just a couple of verses that I think can give us a goal line. And I love what Paul says in 1 Corinthians. He says, "For now, we see but a faint reflection of riddles and mysteries as though reflected in a mirror. But one day, we will see face to face. My understanding is incomplete now, but one day I will understand everything, just as everything about me has been fully understood." At this point in time, the Apostle Paul is going, hey, here's the deal. There's a lot of things that I just don't know. But one day that will be revealed. But until then, in the meantime, here are the things that I'm going to hang my hat on. There are three things that remain: faith, hope, and love. Yet love surpasses them all. What I want to do this weekend is I want to look at those three areas of our life. I think these three areas make up areas for us to be able to evaluate. How solid are we in our faith? How solid are we in our hope? How solid are we in our love? And what I want to look at them as tanks, because I can see that sometimes they go up, sometimes they go down, just depending on the circumstances. And the first thing that we're going to look at is, well, one, our faith. I want to ask you this question. How's your faith tank? How's your faith? Like right now, 2021, how is your faith? I think there are four options of the way that you can answer this question. For some of us, if we're honest, it's gone. We lost it. Something happened, and it just went away. Some of us lost our faith over a breakup. Some of us lost our faith in a pandemic. Some of us lost our faith in an election. Some of us lost our faith because of the economy. I mean, if you could just be honest about where you are with your faith, how is it? Because it's pretty easy in 2021 to lose it altogether. Another option for some of us is just stagnant. It's not going anywhere. It's in one place. Perhaps you lost your spiritual rhythm over the last 365 days, and it's not going anywhere. It's just neutral. For some of us, it's fading. It's diminishing. Seems like every time we open our phones or every time we have a conversation with someone, we can just feel like it's just dwindling away. And then there are some of us in the room, some of us that are watching, that would say, you know what, my faith is growing. And I believe all of us have to wrestle this to the ground and go, you know what, okay, how do I get to that growing space and how do I remain growing in my faith? What I want you to understand is this: the greatest enemy of our faith is fear. The greatest enemy of our faith is fear. And the reality around faith and fear is both of them are fed. Did you know that almost everything you're doing on a daily basis is feeding fear or faith? This is happening on a regular basis. They're fed. Think about it. It's often called a news feed. It is feeding us some sort of information, and something happens to us when we get that information. Here's what I know about you, and here's what I know about me. It takes very little work to feed our fear, right? Because all you got to do is turn on your TV. Like, that ain't hard. Bam. And right away, you could be fed fear. And it takes great intentionality to feed our faith. That takes actual work. Like, that's a person that's waking up and going, I don't want my faith to be stagnant, and I don't want to lose my faith. So today, I'm going to do something about it. I found that there are two things that influence our faith or fear the most: our schedule and our friends. You might be saying, schedule? Well, I want you to think of it like this. What did you spend the last 30 days doing? Statistically speaking, the average churchgoer attends church once a month, okay? Let's just say you're amazing and you're like one of those three weekend people, okay? Like that's incredible, okay? Well, If you're looking at your calendar, what are you doing the other 27 days? If we were to just analyze our schedules just for a moment, wherever you are, wherever you're watching, I just want you to answer this question this weekend. Where's God in this? Because this is what most of our schedules look like on some level or another, and especially when you got kids. My kids' stuff isn't even on my schedule, but I know it's there. It's always present, some way, somehow. Yet, I have to pause myself and go, where's God in all this? Where did I make time for God? What are you doing outside of church to feed your faith? What are you doing outside of church to feed your faith? I want you to answer this. What are you listening to? What are you listening to? What are you watching? Dare I say, what are you serving? All of these things contribute to the status of our soul. And all of these things can contribute to your faith. I know people who wake up and all that they're fed all day long is bad news. And sometimes it's not just bad news. Sometimes they're following people that all have bad attitudes. And before you know it, they can find themselves having the exact same thing. So we talked about the schedule. Well, what about friends? The people that you're surrounded by the most, what do our friends encourage us to do the most? I got some friends right now. You know what they're encouraging me to do the most? Invest in crypto. That's what they're trying to get me to do right now. Okay, like they're all in, okay? And they're like, this week, they're all depressed. And I'm like, listen, dude, I don't know if I can get on this roller coaster with you. But you start to think about, all right, what about those friends that are very, very intentional? You want to know what a really, really, really great friend asked me to do? April and October are typically really, really busy months for me because they're conference seasons for corporate America and church. And so those months are just absolutely insane. And I was at the airport in Orlando on the phone with a friend, and he said, hey, you need a vacation. I went, man, I'll do that. He goes, yeah, you're going to do that in 2 weeks. And I'm like, but how? Because I got stuff to do. I got a job. I got jobs. Okay, I got, like, what do you mean? He's like, you figure it out. And I'm so grateful that he encouraged me to do something that actually helped replenish my faith. At some point, we have to ask ourselves, not do we just have friends that encourage us, that help propel our faith? But at some point, we have to answer this question. Are we the friends that help other people with their faith? Because it's easy to point the finger at somebody else and go, you're not a good friend. But it's another thing to look in the mirror and go, am I a good friend? Am I helping their faith? Or are we just talking about sports and the stock market? The second area, the second tank, if you will, that I want to look at is hope. Hope. Like, how's your hope tank? When I use the word hope, what I think about is the ability to look forward positively, to be able to look in the future and go, we're going to be all right. I love what Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19 says. It says, we have this hope as an anchor for the soul, firm and secure. You know, what's interesting is that oftentimes we will have a theology based around God exempting us from the storms of life. But in this scripture, he's going, no, you're gonna need an anchor. Why would you need an anchor if you weren't gonna be going through a storm? Some of us have lost hope because we just didn't get what we wanted. Some of us didn't get what we prayed for, and we just lost hope. What would you do if I told you you could get it back and you could find yourself in a very, very, very dark season and still have hope? I love what the Apostle Paul said in Romans 15. It says this, uncontainable joy and perfect peace as you trust in him. And may the power of the Holy Spirit continually surround your life with his super abundance until you radiate with hope. Do you know who's writing this? It's the Apostle Paul, who wrote about two-thirds of the New Testament. There is nothing about the Apostle Paul's life that any of us would be envious of. Not one thing. There's nothing going on in his life to go, ooh, I want that. I mean, if you ever just take a moment and read 2 Corinthians chapter 11, the Apostle Paul will actually give you his resume of everything that he has been through for the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when we look at that, we would go, well, I thought I was having a bad day until I read 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And what we find is that the man that went through the most still had an anchor for his soul, still had something deep down inside his belly that says, we good. He had something inside of him that says, I haven't lost hope. And I have an uncontainable joy while writing letters to churches from prison. Are you serious? And some of us will get so sad and so down because we didn't get the right interest rate on our mortgage. And I'm just going, maybe you missed an opportunity, but you'll be all right. We're talking about a man that has been through literal hell and is still going. Uncontainable joy and hope is available to you right where you are. This is not a king that is writing these words. No, this is a person that has been through the darkest of days. In 1871, there was a businessman and lawyer from Chicago named Horatio Spafford. He had five children, and their youngest son passed away of pneumonia, leaving them with four children. Him and his family planned to go over to Europe on a French ocean liner. And as they were going over to Europe, the trip would take roughly about 9 to 10 days. I believe it was around day four, they crashed into another Irish iron ship, and they had about 12 minutes before their ocean liner would eventually sink. And it took about 276 passengers that lost their lives that day. Sailors were coming by, and they find a woman who is floating on the wreckage. And the wife survived, but all four of her children died that day. They eventually got to Wales, and she sent a message. Obviously, this is in the 1800s, and so she sends a telegram to her husband and said, "What shall I do? I survive alone." And he instantly grabbed his stuff and began to make the trip over to Wales to be with his wife. And at one point, the captain of this new ship that he was on said, "Hey, I want you to know this is the spot where the ship went down, where you lost most of your family." And in that moment, Horatio wrote this: "When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well with my soul, it is well with my soul, it is well. It is well with my soul." That is my prayer for every single person under the sound of my voice. I don't know where things are with you relationally. I don't know where things are with you financially. I don't know where things are in your career. I don't know if you're satisfied with where you are in life, but my hope and prayer is that it would be well with your soul. Does your soul have an anchor this weekend? That through the darkest of days, you have something to hold on to. Something that makes you solid. How's your hope this weekend? If you're trying to evaluate where you are, if you really want to be solid personally, I hope you have an anchor for your soul. The last area that I think we can measure, the last area that I think we can evaluate to say, okay, how are we doing? How can I consistently be growing? How can I find myself in a solid place personally? It's the area of love. I mean, how's your love tank? When I ask the question, how is your love tank? I'm talking about your capacity to show compassion to other people. I'm talking about your capacity to be able to reach out to other people, because if we're honest, some of us just get tired. Some of us just get exhausted from loving our neighbor. Some of us just get tired of always being the one to apologize. Some of us just get weary. We just go, listen, I'm tired of being the only person that's generous. I'm tired of being the only person that's picking up the tab. I mean, how is your love tank? I'm talking about that ability to lay down your own desires for the sake of other people. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 13 says, and now these three remain, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. Before that, it says this, it says, love is patient, love is kind, it does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others, it is not self-seeking. In other words, love is never asking the question, what's in it for me? But if we're honest, aren't most of our romantic relationships about what's in it for me? I was talking with a friend the other day. They were like, hey, I'm so glad I got this guy. He's my complete list. Oh, I wrote out a list. I had 47 things. And guess what? He checked off every box on the list. And I thought, man, that's amazing. Are you his list? Like, did you match all 47? Because if you're not, sounds like a really great deal for you. But I don't know about him. I mean, think about it. For most of us, we're thinking about the expectation that we're putting on somebody else. But love is not self-seeking. So if you're looking for an area in your life where you could grow spiritually and really be solid, I'd start here. So just go, how much of my work relationships, how much of my romantic relationships are centered around what other people can do for me? I mean, name the last time you heard a single person say, you know what I'm looking for? I'm looking for somebody that I can serve the rest of my life. Name the last time you heard somebody say that. Oh yeah, I just can't wait to serve somebody else. That's how great marriages work. It's two people waking up going, what can I do for you? Because I'm not going to be self-seeking. How's your love tank? How much of your world is you waking up going, what can the world do for me? Versus being a person that says, what can I do for the world around me? I love what Jesus said in John chapter 13, verse 35, he says, your love for one another will prove to the world that you are my disciples. Jesus is going, hey, if we're having a marketing meeting, just everybody come in really fast. All right, we're putting some things on the whiteboard. Okay, this is what we're gonna hang our hat on, like love. This is what everyone's gonna know us by. This is the tagline. This is, you pick the color schemes, okay? Like, I wore a purple sash that you think I wore, but whatever. Purple, red, blood, whatever, I don't care, but love. So this is what we should be known for. But if you were to just ask your friends, your family members that wouldn't consider themselves church people, that definitely wouldn't consider themselves Christians, how many of them would go, yep, Christians, yeah, that group of people that show a crazy amount of love for other people. Yep, that group of people that they're just not in it for themselves, yeah, those people. Can you imagine if we were a community of people that had the utmost faith, that had hope in the darkest of times, that had anchors for our souls, and we weren't self-seeking? I think you and I have an opportunity to rebrand Christianity in our neighborhoods, at our schools, at our jobs, just by exhibiting faith, hope, and love that is so uncommon, that is so uncanny, that people at your job, people in your neighborhood, people at the grocery store, people, they just usually don't do that. Man, my hope and prayer for each and every one of us is that we'd be solid. That when we look at all three of these areas, whether it's your faith tank, your hope tank, or your love tank, that this weekend you would say, Spirit of God, fill me up. Maybe this weekend's a mile marker for you where you say, you know what, I need to change some things. I need to get very, very intentional. I need to put some things on my calendar to say, you know what, I want to be strategic about feeding my faith. I'm going to pick up a book. I'm going to start listening to a podcast that's encouraging my faith. I can only imagine the difference that you and I could make in the world around us if we truly said, you know what, Lord, help us to truly be solid in these areas. And may we be people that perhaps rebrand Christianity in the world around us. God, thank you so much for each and every person watching this message. God, I pray that we would make so much space for you. God, I pray that we would never find ourselves in neutral or even walking away from you. I pray, God, that we would truly be able to say that we're solid, even when our circumstances are not. That we would truly be able to say that we're solid, even when our finances are not. That we would truly be able to say that we're solid, even when our businesses are not. May you do something for us that truly lifts our souls. In Jesus' name I pray. Everybody say it. Amen. You can stand with me. And if you're watching online, you can join us. We're getting ready to sing a couple of songs. The first song we're going to be singing is called Build My Life. And it's a song truly about the foundation in which we find our lives on. And I don't know what yours is, but my hope and prayer today is that your foundation would be on Jesus Christ, that you would actually have an anchor for your soul. So join us as we sing.
Well, it's so good to be singing, to be worshiping with you all. And we're going to continue to sing. We're going to sing another song to close out our service. But, man, it's just so good to sing about the trust that we get to have in God. So, yeah, we're going to sing a song that's the reason why we're here, the reason why we sing. And it's just talking about our testimony. So, yeah.
I saw Satan fall like lightning, yeah. And I saw darkness run for cover, oh. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I believe we see. I believe in signs and wonders, oh. And I have resurrection power. Blood and washed in water.
That was great. Awesome. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. We do want to take a moment and let you know that next weekend is our Unity Table event.
Yes, and Unity Table is an opportunity for us to invite someone who may not look like us to a meal or coffee. And really the purpose of it is to just to get to know one another's story, broaden our perspectives, and really just build new friendships. So it's a great opportunity.
Yes, and it goes really in line with our DNA, because at Chase Oaks, we're all about building bridges so that we can cross over those things that divide us.
Yes.
So I hope you can go to our website and check that out. If you're interested in being a part of that, whether as a host or just leading a conversation, we'd be happy to have you.
All right, last thing, whether it's being here for good in our community, launching a new campus, or even creating those master classes, which I'm really excited about, so Matt. But all of this is possible only because of your generosity. And so we just want to say thank you for making a huge difference.
Yes, and if you are not currently giving, but you'd like to start, we've made it really easy for you. You can just go online to our app or our website, and everything's right there for you.
Well, again, we're so glad you are here this weekend to join us online. Make sure you come back next weekend for our last sermon, our last message on our series, Solid. We'll see you then.